I study birds. I'm an ornithologist. Now, when I say that to people, they usually assume I'm one of those crazy people that wakes up in the middle of the night, drives across the country to see some obscure bird. And they're right. I've done things to see birds that many of you would not do to see your parents. I have gone out on a ship in the middle of the winter storm to count gulls. I've spent months on a rock in an ocean to count seabirds. For many summers, I've woken up at 5 o'clock in the morning to watch amazing birds, sparrows. And I do this because I really, really like birds. I think they're beautiful, and I think they're fun. But over the years, I've come to appreciate birds from a different perspective, from a perspective that's more than just fun. Because when you take a closer look at birds, when you spend more than just a second looking at the same individual, the same species, you start to see these amazing parallels between birds and us. You start to realize that we can study birds to answer fundamental questions about our behavior, ourselves, questions that apply to us. And this is important because there are many questions about our behavior, about how we are built, that we can't answer using ourselves because of logistical or ethical challenges. Instead, we use model organisms. For example, to find out how cancer works, we use mice, because mouse cells and human cells and mouse organs and our organs work in much the same way. And by studying mice, we can find out treatments for our diseases. But we can't use mice and humans to study everything. And so today I will show you that birds are a great model system for questions that apply to us about our behavior, our physiology. Birds are a great model for behavior because their social system is really similar to ours. 90% of birds form pairs. They have something like we could call family. In 85% of bird species, both mom and dad take care of the babies, much the same as we do. And this makes birds more similar to us than many mammals because bioparental care is rather rare in the animal kingdom. Birds have personalities. They vary tremendously in how aggressive they are, how sociable they are, how daring they are, much the same way as we do. Birds are also great models for physiology because bird hormones and our hormones are really similar, and our nervous systems work in the same way. And so to demonstrate this, I will tell you three stories from my research and my colleagues' research. I will show you that we can study birds to answer fundamental questions about empathy, sex, and stress. Empathy is a very important human emotion. It's the ability to put ourselves in others' shoes, understand things from others' perspective. Empathy makes us who we are. It allows us to forgive. Have you ever wondered why we have empathy? Why care about others, right? Because the principle of natural selection seems to suggest that we should all be selfish, we should not care about others, but yet we do. Why? We can ask this question in birds. Birds do this thing called mobbing, where they come help each other to drive off predators. This cute European songbird, pied flycatcher, they help their neighbors to drive off predators when they attack their nests. But they're calculating little animals. They only help each other if they're being held back. And this is a famous strategy in game theory. It's called tit for tat. But this strategy is also vulnerable to end up in a complete mess because somebody, by accident, at some point will drop the ball, fail to cooperate, and this whole cooperation will stop. Yet these birds keep cooperating. How do they do it? So Latvian professor TEDxRiga and I show that pied flycatchers maintain cooperation because they're able to understand each other's circumstances. They show empathy. And this is how it works. If a bird is attacked, it needs help from its neighbors. And they usually come to help, and everything is fine. This bird will afterwards cooperate back. But sometimes, the help does not come. If you're playing a strict game of tit for tat, this would lead to a breakdown of cooperation because this animal would never, ever talk to these guys again. But these pied flycatchers sometimes bend these rules. They forgive birds that couldn't come to help because of honest reasons, such as they just weren't home, but they refused to cooperate with birds that did not help even if they were able to. So empathy, the ability to forgive some but not all, enables these birds to keep cooperation going. And while human empathy surely is a much more complicated emotion, our research shows that it's also very ancient, that it's shared between birds and humans, and it likely evolved to help us cooperate. Birds can teach us about our sexual behavior. So similarly to humans, birds appear monogamous, which means that they form pairs, they have something like a family, but they also cheat, have sex with other individuals all the time. This happens like something around like 30% of the time. And so why is that? Why do birds cheat? Now, in terms of evolution, the answer may be kind of straightforward for males, because the more you cheat, the more females you have sex with, the more children you have, and so you pass your genes on to the next generation more successfully. But for females, the answer is less straightforward. In most species, the number of children a female can have is limited. It's constrained to a certain number. And so why spend time and energy trying to find different fathers for your children if you have a perfectly willing partner at home? And you can imagine how hard it would be to study this question in humans, right? Instead, we use a large population of this gray-brown American sparrow called dark-eyed junco. We catch these birds at cheating much the same way as we catch people at cheating. We use their DNA. We compare the DNA between the moms, their babies, and all the males in the population. With this year after year after year, we follow the babies, we follow the babies' babies. And so a human equivalent of this would be to study an entire town for something like 200 years, right? So pretty hard task. So using these techniques, Professor Ellen Kerrison and Dr. Nikki Gerlach, with whom I've had the pleasure to work with at Indiana University, show that cheating can be advantageous, that birds that cheat have higher evolutionary fitness. And this is why. Imagine two females. One female, the faithful one, has sex only with her partner. The other, the promiscuous female, has sex with her partner, but also cheats with this other sexy dude. And sexy in this species means older, bigger, and this big white tail. They both have the same number of babies because they can only lay 4 eggs. But what the promiscuous female has that the faithful one does not is the son that was fathered in that promiscuous mating, and the son grows up to be just like his dad. He has a lot of sex with a lot of females and produces a lot of children. And the result of this thing is that the promiscuous female has way more grandchildren than the faithful one. This is called the good genes hypothesis. And this shows that cheating can have an evolutionary advantage. That's an evolved behavior. I'm not saying that you should go out and cheat tonight. That would be kind of bad. But if you do, you might just end up with really sexy children. So the desire to have sex does not stand alone. There are many things that affect our desire to reproduce, and one of the biggest ones is stress. So it's a big thing in our lives. When I'm stressed, such as before this TED Talk, I don't want to go party. I don't want to have sex, and I'm sure many people in this audience and in the backstage feel the same way. So why? How does stress affect our reproduction? Why does this happen? We can ask this thing in birds. We can ask this in birds because many aspects of stress and reproduction are regulated by hormones, and birds and humans share hormones that are nearly identical. We both have testosterone that's produced in our gonads that regulates in both males and females sexual behavior and development. We both have glucocorticoids, stress hormones that are produced in the adrenal glands here. And we also share estrogen, progesterone, oxytocin, adrenaline, like, and the list goes on and on and on. So our hormones, these complicated, intricate systems, are nearly identical. They're probably so ancient they were present in dinosaurs. And so we can use these parallels, we can capitalize on these similarities to study birds to answer questions about ourselves, about how stress affects reproduction. And a good candidate for this effect is testosterone, right? Because testosterone is so important in reproduction. So I asked these brown American sparrows how does stress affect testosterone. And it's a big effect. So when you stress these birds out, when their life is in danger, when they perceive that their life is threatened, they reduce their testosterone levels, and they jump up. And this might not be bad. This might actually be good, because maybe it's better to focus your energy responding to the stress rather than being distracted by sex. But for some of us, stress is not just this one-time thing. It's a constant occurrence. We're stressed day after day after day. What happens to our testosterone? I asked this in these birds. And I showed that if you develop in a really traumatic, this nerve-wracking environment, you have lower testosterone, generally, and that's not bad. But you're also less sensitive to stress, and that's a good thing. So my research shows that stress and development can have major effects on your testosterone. And by understanding the mechanisms by which stress affects our lives, by which stress affects reproduction, we can move towards finding cures and solutions for problems that affect us, our own problems and diseases. So we can learn from birds about stress. Now, we can't use birds to study everything. It wouldn't make sense to study cancer in birds because their organs are a little different from ours. But because their physiological and nervous systems are so similar to us, because their behavior, their social behavior, is so similar to ours, we can use birds to ask basic questions about empathy, about cooperation, stress, sex, and many more things. For example, we can study birds to study personalities. Why are there so many personalities? How are they regulated? We can study birds to understand how cities affect our behavior and our hormones. We can study birds to understand how parenting works, because there's not many animals where both mom and dad take care of the babies. This cover is from the Science magazine, one of the most famous and influential magazines in science. And in this edition, scientists show that we can learn from birds about speech development, because song development in birds and development of speech in humans share many parallels at the physiological level. So there's much more to birds than just their looks. As ornithologists, we're crazy people. We don't wake up there at 5 o'clock in the morning and drive across the country. We do that not only because we want to marvel at the birds, at their beauty, and how fun they are, but also because we want to learn fundamental truths about ourselves, about how nature works, about how evolution works. In fact, one of the birds that has taught us the most about ourselves is this seemingly unremarkable gray-brown American sparrow. But when you take a look at it, when you spend some time looking at it, you realize how much you can learn from it. So next time you see a bird, ask yourself, can I learn something from you? Thank you.